keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Taking all I have and now I'm laying it at your feet. You have every failure, God, and you will have every victory. Every victory, 'cause you say I am loved when I can't feel a thing. And you say I am strong when I think I am weak. And you say I am held when I am falling short. When I don't belong, oh, you say I am yours. And I believe. Oh, I believe what you say of me. Oh, I believe. Oh, I believe what you say of me, Jesus.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Good evening. Thank you so much for joining us for tonight's, the beginning of our series, Christ's Seven Last Statements. It's great to be with you all. We're thankful to God for just blessing everyone to see another day, to come on and just share the gospel and the good news and what Christ had to say when he was dying on the cross for our sins. So welcome one, welcome all. We ask that you share the link with your friends, your family, neighbors, so that we can have as many people as possible to hear tonight's beautiful, beautiful program. So to start, we will have song service by Sister Shakira Lewis. And Shakira, are you on?
Actually, I am going to be doing the song service tonight.
Okay. So
Right.
we have our very own beautiful Elder Rachel Toro, and Let Your Hearts Be Blessed by the song service.
All right. Thank you, everyone, for joining us tonight for our Christ Last Statement series. And I am going to sing a few songs tonight just to lift up Christ, lift up the cross, because that is what we are spotlighting tonight. So I am going to say a quick word of prayer also just for us to begin. Father, we thank you for this day that you have made. Let us rejoice and let us be glad in it, dear God. And as we lift up the cross, dear God, we pray that someone may take up the mantle, someone may be born to call you blessed, dear Lord, and that this series, dear God, that was so great for us last year, will continue to bless us this year in Jesus' name. Amen. So I
Amen.
want to sing at the cross, song number 163, at the cross, at the cross. Last and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for someone such as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I have done he suffered on the tree? Amazing beauty, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Dear Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. And the next song that we're going to sing tonight is song number 159, The Old Rugged Cross. Song number 159, The Old Rugged Cross. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. But I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, that old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to the Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I would ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
Thank you so much, our dear Elder Toro. That was beautiful. And now we're going to have our theme song, which is How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
This is the camera. Are we hearing it?
I'm sorry?
Are you
No,
here?
no, we can't hear. I'm sorry. Thank you, everyone, for being so patient. We're just getting on our theme song for this evening, which is How Deep the Father's Love for Us. Thank you for being so patient with us.
Let's move on and I'm going to come back to it. You heard me say it again?
I'm sorry?
Let's move on and then we're going to come back to it.
Okay, so we'll come back to our theme song for this evening. So let me just start with welcoming everyone. Thank you, everyone, for joining this evening. I hope and pray that you had a wonderful Sunday. We ask right now that you even share the link for whether it be via Zoom or YouTube for tonight's, the beginning of our series, Christ's Seven Last Statements. I just want to welcome everyone. This is a week-long series that will end on Friday evening and with our community day at Living Word SDA Church on Sabbath, this coming Sabbath. I just, I'm so blessed and so thankful that I was asked to host. My name is Sister Kim Kozier, and I'm so happy to be here. I'll be hosting this evening. Tonight's series begins with Christ's statement, "Father, forgive them." And just thinking about the fact that our Lord and our Savior, after all the turmoil and all the abuse that he went through, when they hung him on that cross, he was still thinking of us. So I would think that we should start up the chat, and everyone who is able, just put in the chat, "Thank you, Lord," because thank God for Jesus that we serve a Savior that is not a wimp, and he is brave and courageous, and he was thinking of us. And imagine the things that we go through on a daily basis, and we just cave. Imagine that this is what our Lord and our Savior was willing to do for us. And even in the midst of all the hurt, he still found the strength to ask for our forgiveness. How great. And so, what is even the importance of forgiveness? What's the importance of forgiveness, even? Why do we need to forgive? Well, in my personal experience, forgiveness frees us. It frees us because no matter how someone has hurt you or has done wrong unto you, when you forgive them, you free yourself of the baggage that comes with that and the bad feelings. And what happens is that festers into other relationships. And to just free yourself. And also the Bible tells us that if we want our Father in heaven to forgive us, we must also forgive. So I would think in the chat we would put forgiveness, because that's what tonight's message is, that our Lord and Savior, under the most duress situation, was pleading for our forgiveness, for our forgiveness. So we thank God for Jesus and his mercy. And now we will go into our opening prayer by Sister Denise Cross. Sister Cross, thank you for joining. And we can go into our opening prayer. Sister Cross, are you ready? No, we can't hear you, Sister Cross.
I think I'm going to play the theme song, give her time to log out and log back in.
Okay. So we'll have our theme song now. And our theme song is "How Deep the Father's Love."
Thank you.
That was our theme song, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. And if Sister Denise is ready, we will
Hello.
Have a prayer. Yes, we can hear you, Sister Denise.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Lord.
Let us pray. Father God, you are our Heavenly Father. And tonight, even as we face so many challenges in starting this series, God, we lift our arms and we praise you. We give glory to your most honorable name, because we know that no matter what the devil comes with, you are in charge, dear Jesus, and your words must be heard. So, Father God, tonight we are so blessed to be able to come in this fashion. Lord, we still have a chance to speak your name. There are so many all the world over who cannot speak your name freely. But Lord, we are blessed. And we recognize that, and we thank you, Jesus. Lord, you have said that the harvest is plentiful, the laborers are few. And so as we begin this series, dear God, we are asking you, we're thanking you first for giving us this chance. But Lord, we're asking for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We earnestly pray, dear God, that you send us out as laborers into your harvest. Lord, let everything that we do this week and tonight be because it's a testimony of you, dear Lord Jesus. It's a testimony that we trust you and we love you, dear God, and we understand the in everything that you, dear Father Jesus, let us do it to your name's honor and glory. Lord, we ask you to soften our hearts, that we may receive your words. We ask you to bless the manservant you have chosen tonight. Speaks, dear God, of you, dear Jesus, and let it fall into grounds that are ready, dear Lord Jesus, to receive. Soften us, dear Father Jesus. Lord, as we focus on what you have done for us, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you that despite who we are, you still love us. And you're still there. Your blood was not shed in vain. We receive you, dear Father. Bless the speaker of the night. Bless every proceedings, we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you so much, Sister Cross, for that beautiful prayer. Now we will have a special song given by Elder Toro.
Oh,
Amen. Amen. We are thankful for Shakira for that beautiful, Sister Shakira for that beautiful song service. And now here's the part where you all can participate. So you might not have been asked to sing. You might not be the one delivering the message tonight. You might not be the one hosting, or you might not be the one delivering a prayer. But we ask now that you participate by giving up an offering to God to further his cause, and we will provide the QR code so that you can participate in the tithes and offering. Do we have the QR code available? There we go. So you can also use the phone number if you have Zelle. You can also put in the phone number and it should pop up on your Zelle app or your bank app. And we just ask that you be gracious and give an offering to further the cause of the Lord. So there's the QR code. You can scan it. You can also download the Adventist Giving app and search for Living Word SDA Church. Give you a few minutes to do that. And we thank you so much in advance for your graciousness and giving unto the cause of the Lord. Okay, and now we're going to have a testimony. Thank you. So tonight we're going to have a testimony by someone who I've known all my life from birth, and maybe even before that. So tonight's testimony will be given by my dad, Brother Bentley Ward. Dad, are you ready to go?
Yes.
Okay. If you can just share your wonderful face. You can start your video. And then you can begin when you're ready.
Okay. Can y'all hear me?
Yes, we can, loud and clear.
Good evening, church family. How's everyone doing?
Praise the Lord.
Thanks to the Lord for that. First, let me say, my name is Bentley Ward, for those who don't know. And this evening is made possible and part of this program because of my baptism, which I did in last year, June. And I have to give thanks to two members that came and prepped me for the baptism. Sister Dawkins and Brother Griffiths. And I'm happy that I got baptized, because it was a step in the right direction. And what motivated me was that all my family members, even my little grandson, 11 years old, got baptized. So it wasn't nothing for me to wait for. So I give God thanks and praise for that. And I'm enjoying it, you know, coming to Sabbath on the Sabbath, and I come and worship with the members, and I'm enjoying it. And what happened is I went on a vacation last year, just before the Christmas season. I went to Barbados to spend vacation with my parents, who is, you know, up in age. And I returned in January, late January. And I came back doing well. I felt fine and everything was all right. But then a week after, I felt like I was catching a cold. I went to the urgent care and they tested me to say I had a flu. So they gave me a prescription for medication. I took that medication, but I don't think anything was going on. So the other stuff was going on. Other stuff was going on. So my wife told Kim the following Friday, you have to take him to the doctor. So she called up and they said, take him to the emergency. So she said, Dad, you gotta get dressed and we gotta go. Okay, I did that. Although all that time I didn't feel in a way sick, but I don't know why, but because a lot of stuff was going on. Anyhow, we went to the urgent care and there, you know, to check me out and then they start giving me treatment and they admitted me to the ward that Friday, early Friday night. And I spent 6 nights in the hospital. And thanks to Kim, she spent 5 nights in the hospital. And, you know, that was great for me because she was so helpful to me that I can't give her enough thanks. I can't give her enough thanks for being there for me. So she was very helpful, helping me. She was like my private nurse. So I thank her for that. So, okay, I came home and while I was in the hospital, the pastor called me to check on me and also prayed for me, which was heartfelt. That was great. And then I thanked all my church brothers and sisters for all their prayers and all their well wishes. Get well wishes and the same messages by my family and asking for me all the time. I appreciate that and I ask God to bless you all because that was heartfelt to me. Also, Brother Julius called me just as I got out the hospital. Brother Julius called me and to see how he was doing. And he also prayed for me. And that was great. I felt wanted. I felt love by my church members. So I want to say I have so much thanks to give God for what you have taken me through. And prayers do work. Prayers do work. And I know that the prayers that my church family sent you help. Along with I pray and I thank my family for their support. And I thank everyone for their kindness and their love. And I ask God to bless all of you. And I love you all in Jesus' holy name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Dad. You were deserving. It was nothing that I, you know, it was nothing. You're my dad. I wasn't going to leave you in there by yourself. So thank you so much for your testimony, Dad. And I thank God that, you know, he called you and you hardened not your heart and you answered the call to be baptized and we're blessed as a family for it. So praise God for that. And now we will have our very own Pastor Everett Taylor with the introduction of tonight's speaker, Pastor Taylor.
Thank you very much, Sister Kim. Thank you very much, Brother Bentley. We're here this evening because of the catalyst of the cross, the one and only Jesus Christ, the undisputed, undefeated champion of love. We glory in nothing save the cross of Jesus and him crucified. The cross brings us near to God. The Jews stumbled at the idea that the cross brings salvation. The Greeks say it is foolishness because they believe in science and higher learning. Judaism teachers embrace Christianity, but they said we are ashamed of the cross. But all of us as members of the Living Word Church, all our joys hangs in the cross. To remove the cross from Christianity is like blotting out the sun out of the universe. And that's why we're having our Christ Seven Last Statements series. And this is the opening evening. God has sent us a man, not an ordinary man, but an extraordinary man. It is not so easy to introduce those you really, really know, because there are so many things you would want to say. Let me share a few pieces about the man. When I started my ministerial journey, he was already there many years ahead of me. He was, I think, the second pastor when I attended my first pastor's meeting, who came over to me, greeted me, and gave me royal welcome. When I was through with my internship, he was serving at the conference office as the personal ministries and Sabbath school director. And so in the Caribbean, when you're assigned your first pastoral district, they assign one of the directors from the conference to give you supervision. And Pastor Monroe was my supervisor, and I learned so much from him. This evening, he comes to us ready because he's driven by the Spirit. Currently, he serves as a senior pastor for the Maranatha Church right here in Brooklyn, and also as the Associate Family Ministries Director for the Greater New York Conference right here in New York. He's married to a wonderful ministry companion. Amira is her first name. The union has produced two wonderful children. Matthew, I think it was just about 3 weeks ago, Matthew passed through Living Word to see his friends. Yes. You know, Shakira sang earlier, and, you know, her sister and the others, they're Matthew's friend, and he passed by to say hello, came and greeted me, and Jana, their little daughter. Here he, an eloquent, industrious man of God, with the opening word under the subject, Father, forgive them, they know not what they have done, after the song of meditation. The next voice is the voice of the only man, Lawndale Leopold Monroe, man of God.
The ship is better. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Sister Shakira Lewis, for those two beautiful numbers. Pray for me, the first one, and the Anchor Holds, one of my personal favorite songs. Thank you so much, my wonderful host, Kim Kozier. So graceful, you know, so wonderful in hosting, you know, there's such grace in hosting, and I want to thank you, your dad, as he gave that beautiful testimony, Brother Bentley Ward, and of course, Sister Elda Tora with the song service. Now, I just love your pastor in a special, special way, because we connected, I believe, in 2009, 2010, and it was a difficult era he was placed in. They never see evangelism, you know, never baptize many, but we just connected in such a special way. He asked me to be the speaker. I was a supervisor. I didn't have to ask me to be the speaker. And I tell you this, that which wasn't done because of the tremendous industry and energy of your pastor and his willingness to really accept a few little tips from me. We saw 100 precious souls baptized in an era where maybe 20 or 30 was the number. So if you can, in your chat, just affirm your pastor. Put pastor, we affirm you, we love you, in the chat right now, whether you're on the YouTube or on this Zoom platform. Come on, somebody. Please affirm your pastor right now before I go any further. Yes, he's a tremendous gifted person. And he has a beautiful wife that is supporting him and their daughter, Zaria. I just love them. The only problem I have with Pastor Taylor is that he wouldn't give Zaria a little baby brother. I have a little issue with him. He's a tremendous evangelist. As a matter of fact, he has outstripped me now when it comes to evangelism. And but he need to evangelize in that particular era. And since I'm in family ministry, I got to push that one. welcome and good evening, everyone. And I trust that we'll have a wonderful time. I picked the topic for the Forgive Me. I didn't realize it was the first one, as I would have picked one in the middle where the better speakers would come. But your pastor hoodwinked me there, put a wool over my eyes. Nevertheless, let's get into the Word of God. I know I don't have a much of a time. And the title is, you can type it in the chat where you are, Say a Prayer. Say a Prayer. Come on, type it. You got to help somebody else who's not concentrating. Say a Prayer. Let's pray. Father God, we open your words. We are not wise enough, so we invite your Holy Spirit to just be with us. Let the words of my mouth really be the meditation of your hearts. Challenge your people to live righteously, we pray. We say thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. The text is Luke 23, verse 34. Luke 23, verse 34. I'm reading from the King James Version. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So what is Jesus doing? I ask, what is Jesus doing? Well, the answer is obvious. Jesus is praying. But wait a minute. Men don't usually pray on crosses. We pray in gardens, don't we? We pray in church buildings. We pray where we can get away from the noise and confusion of the world and think clear thoughts. We don't pray on crosses. You curse on crosses. You scream on crosses. You cry on crosses. You experience excruciating pain on crosses. Now, don't you ever forget that Jesus is always the Savior. His hand cannot minister to the sick, for he's on the cross, for they are nailed on the tree. His feet cannot carry him on errands of mercy, for they are fastened on the wood. But one thing he can do and does, he prays. Our Lord is on the cross, brothers and sisters. He prays for his murderers. The rulers sneer, the soldiers mock, the criminals insult, the mob jeer. Still, he prays. Ah, this teaches me that no one, no situation is beyond the reach of prayer. Oh, this is tweetable. This is repeatable. That no one, no situation is beyond the reach of prayer. Keep on praying, my brothers and sisters. When you're facing a challenging situation, keep on praying when you're feeling overwhelmed. Keep on praying when you're in need of healing. Keep on praying when you're seeking guidance. Keep on praying when you're expressing gratitude. Say a prayer. You're not feeling me, so let me do it another way. The Bible says in the King James Version, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. You're still not feeling me. Hear my cry, O God, says the psalmist. Attend unto my prayer. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For thou hast been a shelter for me and a strong tower from the enemy. Somebody ought to say amen. Say a prayer. Question is, what kind of mind dreams of crucifixion? Run the question again. Somebody missed it. What kind of mind dreams of crucifixion? Well, it was originated by Persians, perfected by Romans. Romans did not want individuals to die quickly. They would not be satisfied. Crucifixion, you see, was entertainment for Romans. That's why they perfected the art of crucifying people slowly. Crucifixion was torture at its supreme best. What kind of mind, transpose, what kind of mind dreams of some of the things we call entertainment? The horror movies, entertainment, the boxing matches, entertainment, the human trafficking, the music. The cartoons, which is now are not ghoulish in appearance, they are cute and charming, entertaining. Who in the world think these things up? In Genesis 6, verse 5 would bring us a kind of an answer. And God says, Genesis 6, verse 5, type it in the chat. God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. What's the point when the devil possesses our hearts and our minds? Unrestrained evil is imagined and executed, and that is entertainment. Say it again. When the devil possesses our hearts, unrestrained evil is imagined and executed. Jesus hangs there, experiencing the result of man's twisted thinking and twisted entertainment, and he begins to pray. It was not just once Jesus prayed this prayer, but many times. Jesus said, underline the word said, Father, forgive them. The verb tense of the word, and I'm not going to get into the bore you with the Greek. The verb tense of the word said, expresses continuous, repeated action. Oh, let me see if I can put it where you can reach it. Again and again, he prayed. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Oh, I'm boring you a bit, but I'm trying to help you understand what is happening in the text. I wonder how many times he prayed it. Did he pray it when they whipped him with the flagellum, that cat o' nine? Did he pray it when they thrust a crown of thorns upon his head, and put a purple robe around his shoulders, and mocked him by saying, Hail, King of the Jews? How many times on the cross did he pray this prayer? It's an intercessory prayer, you see, brothers and sisters. He's earning the right to be your advocate. He's earning the right to be your high priest. Isaiah 53, the suffering servant, the high priest servant, says, verse 12 says, Jesus made intercession for transgressors. Jesus made intercession for transgressors. He's earning the right to be your advocate right there on the cross of Calvary. And this tells me something. Here's a word that we ought to learn. Here's a lesson. Repetitiveness of forgiveness is critical. Can I say it again? Repetitiveness of forgiveness is critical. Why? Come here. Matthew 18:29. You stand as a witness. Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till seven times? Jesus saith unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times. Here's the point. You see, resentment, you ought to type that word, resentment can have such a grip on your heart that you need to forgive that person often for your own healing. You need to forgive that person often for your own healing. Every time you remember the hurt, you got to forgive the person again. I said, say a prayer. You have to forgive those who trespass against you over and over again, as long as resentment and bitterness are still having a place in your heart. I hope you're getting it, brothers and sisters. Jesus' example here on the cross invites us to rise to the level of pure forgiveness. Pure, P-U-R-E, pure forgiveness. You see, it's easy to set our sights too low when it comes to forgiveness. What do you mean, preacher? Most forgiveness is earned forgiveness. Can I say it again? Most forgiveness is earned forgiveness. Luke 17 verse 3. And nothing is wrong with Luke 17 verse 3. We should practice Luke 17 verse 3. The Bible says, take heed to yourselves. If thy brother trespass against thee, rebuke him. And if he repent, forgive him. If he repent, forgive him. Let's break it down. He shows remorse, she repents, I forgive. That's why I call it earned forgiveness. The person does something, so you forgive the person. The person says, I'm sorry. The person says, I apologize. The person shows remorse. The person buys you flowers, ladies, wines, that kind of, you forgive the person. The Bible is full of this type of forgiveness. It's practical. It's necessary. We have to say sorry when we do something wrong. Luke here argues that if a fellow, anybody at all, repents, we have to forgive. But he simply does not mention, slow it down, preacher, the other side. If the person does not repent, if the person does not repent. So, let me pose a question. What if the person never apologizes? Do you not forgive? What if the person never repents? Do you not forgive? What if the person is a psychopath? Just don't have the ability. What if the person is bipolar? What if the person is Phineas Gage? Gage. I'm going to tell you the story about him in a bit. What if the person is dead? I may need, ladies, somebody here, I may need to forgive my dead father who abused me sexually, emotionally, otherwise. But he's dead. The case of Phineas Gage. In 1848, a tamping iron bore through his skull. He went from being a very well-liked person to fitful, irreverent, cursing, oh, everybody, grossly profane, showing little respect for others. An iron went through his brain, and miraculously survived it. But after that, he was the most terrible person you could meet. Ah, here's a lesson. The brain, a damaged prefrontal cortex changes personality. I said a damaged prefrontal cortex changes personality. It's a classic case in psychology. Again, I pose the question, what if the person never apologizes? I'm talking to somebody on this platform. I'm talking to somebody on YouTube. I'm talking to somebody on the internet wave, struggling with the issue of forgiveness. There is somebody that you need to forgive. There is somebody that every time you think about the person, there's resentment. There's bitterness in your heart. What if the person never repents? Holding that grudge forever imprisons you forever. Say it again, preacher. Holding that grudge forever imprisons you forever. Holding that grudge forever poisons you. You see, unforgiveness is a poison I drink, hoping others would die. I wish somebody is getting this. For free the prisoner. This evening I'm saying free the prisoner. Free yourself, because you're the prisoner. Free the prisoner. Free yourself. Forgiveness is healing. Forgiveness is a healthy lifestyle. You exercise, that's a healthy lifestyle. You eat right, that's a healthy lifestyle. Forgiveness is a healthy lifestyle. Because you see, resentment can have such a grip on your heart that you need to forgive that person for your own healing. Resentment can have such a grip on your heart that you need to forgive that person often for your own healing. What if the person never apologizes? What if the person never repents? Well, Jesus answers this question on the cross. That's our text for this evening. Luke 17:3 brings you one side. If I come and I repent, you can forgive. But the other side of the question, flip side of the coin is, what if the person never repents? Jesus answers this question on the cross. Is anybody seeing the text now? Jesus says, you also forgive him. You also forgive him. But remember, forgiveness is part of a healthy lifestyle. Remember that forgiveness frees you, the prisoner. You need to forgive that person for your own healing. I wish I could reach somebody this evening. I wish I had time to tell you that forgiveness is not reconciliation. You gotta get your theology right. It's a standalone experience. Reconciliation is reconciliation. It's an experience all by itself. Forgiveness is forgiveness. I wish somebody could hear me this evening. I wish somebody could understand this subject this evening. I wish I had time to tell you that forgiveness is not condoning what was done. The fact that you forgive means a person did you wrong. That's why you forgive. If the person is doing well, you don't forgive. If the person is doing right, you don't forgive. If the person has done wrong, you forgive. As a matter of fact, it's a command from Jesus. And if you don't forgive men their sins, it's an imperative. It's a command from God. You've got to learn to forgive before the Father himself forgives you. Can I get a witness in this place? So what is Jesus praying? Say a prayer, say a prayer, say a prayer, say a prayer. He prays, for they know not what they are doing. We're so held by the power of sin that we think that sinful behavior is normal behavior. So Jesus, oh God, forgive them. Remember, he's the high priest on the cross praying, interceding. He's an intercessor. When we sin, we call it a blunder. But Jesus calls it blindness. When we sin, we call it a mistake, but God calls it madness. When we sin, we call it a weakness, but God calls it willfulness. When we sin, we call it an error, but God calls it enmity. When we sin, we call it a fascination, but God calls it a fatality. When we sin, we call it an infirmity, but God calls it iniquity. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. I feel like preaching a little bit. Now, this seems an odd argument. Our Savior presents here to the Father. I mean, you're an intercessor. I mean, you're a pleader for me. I mean, you're an advocate for me. I mean, you're a lawyer for me. What kind of an argument? What kind of defense you're putting up? Remember, I'm in the guilty chair. Remember, I'm the defendant. In pleading the case of another, you usually affirm his innocence. You don't acknowledge his guilt. What kind of a lawyer is Jesus? Well, Jesus acknowledged man's guilt as he argued for God to forgive. Why? Why? Because Jesus already knew the answer to the prayer was the cross. I said the answer to the prayer was the cross. How could God forgive the guilty? The cross was the answer. So Jesus prays, say a prayer, say a prayer. Give all of the sinning evil people a chance to be redeemed. Jesus is praying. Do not let them pay God. I'm paying the price, Father. Give them a chance to repent, to be cleansed, to be made new. Give angry crowds a chance to get right with you, God. Give Roman soldiers who drive nails into my hands a chance to repent. Brothers and sisters, come here a little bit. The soldiers in their work of crucifixion had seen it all. They had wrestled with desperate convicts resisting their crucifixion with almost superhuman strength. They'd watch men accept execution with noble resignation. They had crucified whimpering, compliant, broken men. They have heard in the past curses, but never had they convicted. Never have they heard a convict pray for them. I said, never had they heard a convict pray for them. Can't you see? I wish somebody would stay with me. Can't you see that when he was on the cross, you and I were on his mind? Can't you see that his mind passed from his own, his Jesus, his own suffering to the sins of persecutors? Can't you see his mind pass from their sins to their salvation? Hallelujah. Pardon them, my Father. Forgive them, my Father. Give them a chance to accept me. And the question tonight is, I'm bringing this to a close in a moment or two. Will you live as one forgiven? I said, will you live as one forgiven? Because God has forgiven you right there on the cross. You have been forgiven. So live as one forgiven. Let go, let go, let go of the bitterness. Let go of the resentment. Let go of the hurt. Let go, let. Somebody type in the chat, let go, with 5 or 6 exclamation marks. Let go of the bitterness. Let go of the resentment. Let go. Now, you may not have the spiritual strength and emotional strength to forgive right away. But you can ask God to do what you cannot do. Father, come on. Stay with me in the text. Father, you forgive them. Jesus had authority to forgive. He had the spiritual maturity to enable him to release his tormentors from their responsibility to him. But instead of announcing forgiveness from himself, he prayed that his Father would do the forgiving. And you can do this. Oh, I gotta say it again because somebody missed it. Instead of announcing forgiveness from himself, he prayed that his Father would do the forgiving. And you can do the same. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, he's leaving an example right there on the cross. As he did at his baptism, so he does on the cross. He knew we would struggle with forgiveness. He knew we would struggle with pure forgiveness. I said he knew we would struggle with pure forgiveness. So I'm talking to somebody this evening. I'm talking to myself. You can pray from your cross situation. I said you can pray from your cross situation. You can pray from your cross situation. What is your cross situation? You can pray from your cross situation. Forgiveness, he may never confess. She may never repent. Reconciliation may never come. You may feel weak. You may struggle with a grudge. Unforgiveness may be poisoning your soul. That's why you have to pray, Father, you forgive them. And he'll give you the strength to forgive. So I interviewed Mr. Lyon. Mr. Lyon, I really don't know the definition of forgiveness. Here's Mr. Lyon's answer, reply to me. I never knew how strong I was until I had to forgive someone who wasn't sorry. I never knew how strong I was until I had to forgive someone who wasn't sorry and accept an apology I never received. I interviewed Miss Matt's teacher. If I interview a mister, I gotta balance it. Equal opportunity employment right here. Miss Matt's teacher, give me your definition of forgiveness. Well, my brother, one cross plus 3 nails. I said one cross plus three nails equal four given. Oh, somebody missing. You gotta tell somebody it's this one. I said one cross plus three rusty nails equal four given. Ah, I gotta put it to where it needs to be. The songwriter capped it all well in this song. His strength is perfect. When all my strength is gone, he'll carry you when you can carry on. Raised in his power, the weak become strong, for his strength. It's perfect when all my strength is gone. You can pray from your cross situation. You can pray from your difficult situation. He may never repent. She may never repent. She may never be sorry. She may never offer an apology. But you can learn to forgive. Because when you do that, you're releasing the prisoner that is you. May God bless you this evening, brothers and sisters, as you learn to forgive, as you rise to the level of pure forgiveness. Ah, don't stay at earned forgiveness. If I repent, then I forgive. No. If you repent, I forgive. Rise to the level of pure forgiveness. Oh, you may need to literally rise like Jesus on the cross to forgive. You may not have the strength. So that's why you ask God, give strength. Oh, God, give me strength to forgive him. Every time you see the sister, you know she played around with your husband in church, and she still is in church. She still sings in the choir. She still acts as if nothing has happened. You've got to learn to pray this prayer. Oh, it's a first word on the cross. It's a first word. Maybe God did it for something. Maybe to save you. See love in action. Learn to forgive. If you learn to forgive, then you've become a Christian. If you've learned to forgive, you've just stepped up your level of Christianity. And may God be with you, brothers and sisters. Upon you as you learn to let go and let him. Can I pray? Oh God and our Father, it's a tough and a difficult subject, learning to forgive, because so many people have hurt us. Maybe a mama has hurt us. Maybe a mama's abused us. Maybe a papa's abused us. Maybe a colleague has abused us. Maybe a sister has done something. And every time we see that sister, maybe a brother has done us something. That money we gave, he hasn't given it back. Whatever it is, God, give us a strength to forgive. Because God, we need to be released. We are imprisoning ourselves. We drink from a cup, but it's a cup of poison, thinking that the other person is receiving that poison. So tonight, across the airwaves, across the internet waves, somebody, do your amazing, majestic, marvelous, miraculous, merciful work, supernatural work of forgiving so that he, she can forgive. Bless your minister and servant in this part of the vineyard, every Tyrone Taylor, his dear wife, beautiful wife. Bless his beautiful daughter. Bless the entire pastoral team, the Torah leading. Bless every single member. God bless us so that we can learn to forgive. We pray all of this in the majestic name of Jesus. Amen and amen. May the Lord be with you, everyone. Thanks for the opportunity to share this evening.
Amen. Amen. What a message. Thank you so much to Pastor Monroe. What a message. And now we'll go into tonight's closing prayer with Sister Denise Cross.
Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Father God, tonight we glory in the cross. Lord, we thank you for the message you sent us. Lord, you have sent us a lesson from the cross. Father, we ask you to forgive us. And Lord, we ask you to help us to accept your forgiveness. Lord, you've already paid the price. And because of guilt and shame, dear Jesus, we cannot claim it, dear Lord. We have such a hard time claiming it, dear Lord, and understanding that you, when you forgive, Lord, you forgive. You don't hold on to hurts. You don't hold on to pain. Lord, we acknowledge those amongst us who have had pain and hurt. And sometimes, Lord, it takes so much to get over it. But Lord, tonight after hearing this message, we understand that hurt, pain, resentment, unforgiveness has no place in you. And so, Lord Jesus, we reject that, dear Lord, and we claim the Holy Spirit, which will help us to get over these things. Father, help us, Jesus. Help us, oh God. Help us, oh Lord, to understand what you did on the cross for us. We are free. And when you have made us free, we are free indeed. Lord, I thank you so much for your manservant. And I ask that you continue to use him in such a marvelous way. We thank you also for our leadership. We thank you for our leader, Everett Taylor. Lord, continue to abide with him. Continue to guide him, guide his thoughts, guide everything he does, dear Father Jesus, because that in turn will help us to stay on the narrow path when our leader is guided by the Holy Spirit. Lord, help us all who are on this program tonight and those who have did not make it. Lord, help them to get the message through someone. Help us to share this message with others. Help us to share what we've learned tonight about forgiveness and letting go and understanding, dear Lord Jesus, that you have already forgiven us of everything. So we need not worry. We need not feel the shame and the guilt anymore. Thank you for hearing and answering our prayer. Continue to abide with this program. Take us through this week. And whatever the devil throws at us, dear Jesus, we're asking you to help us to overcome in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we claim the victory. In the name of Jesus, we claim the change that we must undertake. In the name of Jesus, we claim you, dear God. We hold on to your cleansing blood. And we thank you. Thank you for hearing us. Thank you for being with us. Go with us throughout the week. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you so much, Sister Denise Cross, for that wonderful prayer. So just some takeaways from the message this evening is that forgiveness has to be a repetitive action. So not just because you forgive someone once, you might have to forgive the same person multiple times and for the same thing. And so it has to be a repetitive action. Also, another takeaway is that we were forgiven, so we have to live as forgiven as well. And that was powerful. Let go of the hurt. Let go. Shed the burden. Because when we don't forgive others, we hold on to that burden. It's a heavy load, my brothers and sisters. Let's just shed the burden, shed the weight. And the last takeaway is that one cross plus three nails equals forgiven. So we're so blessed by the message. Thank you so much, Pastor Monroe, for your deliverance of the message tonight. We pray that God continues to bless you, your ministry, and your family. Thank you so much to Sister Denise Cross for the opening and closing prayer. Thank you to Elder Toro for a beautiful song service, Sister Shakira Lewis as well. We want to just affirm Pastor Taylor for his continued ministry and just being there as our shepherd and to lead us. We thank you so much for that. And join us tomorrow, because the series is all week long. Tomorrow's message will be given by Pastor Bernard Lyons of the Grenada Conference. And that message will be, "Today, you shall be in paradise." So our Christ seven last statements continues throughout the week up until Sabbath, this coming Sabbath. So please, we ask that you continue to log on and join us on YouTube or use the Zoom link. Also, please share the link with your friends and your family, your neighbors, your coworkers. And we're just so blessed to have had you. And we continue to just pray and lift each other up in Jesus' most precious and holy name. So thank you so much. And we will see you again tomorrow evening. Thank you so much, and have a great, great and blessed night.
Good night.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measures, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure.
Good night, everyone.